Yo, that was my job.
Yes. Earth, Wind, and Fire. You cannot go wrong.
Oh,
with
my
Earth,
goodness.
Fire.
Yeah, man. Yo, yo, yo. What's up, everybody in listening land? It is the Kevin and Nikki show on iHeartRadio.
Yes.
I'm back to Kevin D. Benton, and
I am actress Nikki Warren, and
we back, man. We always back.
We're always back from somewhere. Something going on.
Yes. Yeah. So, yeah, man, it's time for the
many
adventures of Kevin and Nikki.
The bell
was on time. That was cool. That was cool. That was stuff. All right, so what kind of adventures you had going on there? Should I go first?
You need to go first.
Oh, I need to go first? Okay, let me go first.
All right,
so, yeah, I was on the set of London web series.
Yeah, I remember you were telling me about
that. London.
How did it go?
Oh, it was great. And I want to pronounce London, well, spell London, L-O-N-D-Y-N, web series. And it was great. And the character that I played was Samuel, and I play a drug fiend. I play a drug fiend who is addicted to Oxycontin, and, I'm just fiending for another hit, you know what I'm saying? And so I go through, as a fiend would, go to extensive extremes to try to get that fixed, man. So I'm out there, snatching pocketbooks and, running from car chases and all that other stuff.
Okay.
It was great. But what made it so great was I had to do a dying scene. Like, I actually died in the movie. And this was a role that really, really stretched my ability as an actor. I want to give a shout out to a super talented director, Derek Hammond.
Oh, yeah.
And I know, he probably doesn't like a lot of people to mention this, but he is Will Smith's cousin.
Yeah.
And that just helped to have that kind of blood in you. You know what I'm saying? Actress Erin Sanderson. She's a phenomenal talent, and she kind of does it all. She produced.
Mm-hmm.
She does the boom.
Okay.
She slates.
Okay.
You know what I'm saying? She kind of like the will that helps everything,
keep
everything going.
Then
you got my main man, Tyrone Magnus.
Okay.
This guy got over 1 million hits on YouTube. 1 million. And this series is going to air on his YouTube channel.
Nice.
And, so during the break, man, we actually went on his YouTube channel and got 10,000 hits within that hour. Just us just kidding around, introducing our character.
But I got to ask. I got to ask.
What's that?
Were you shaking?
I had to shake. Now, check this out. I had to eat Xanax.
Ew.
Not real Xanax, but they were actually Altoids.
Nasty.
They were Altoids, and they had to dump them on the ground. And I, like a fiend who don't care about hygiene, I had to pick these Xanax up off the ground and eat.
Wait.
But my breath was smelling good, though.
No.
Yeah.
No. We got to go back.
We got to go back.
You had to eat
Altoids.
From off the ground.
That were dumped on the ground.
Did they put something on under it so that, eating off the ground?
Now, check this out. Remember I told you confession is good for the soul, bad for the reputation? Remember I told you that?
Yeah.
They didn't put nothing under it.
I had to do it.
But listen,
no,
I'm going to tell you.
This
is what I did in the name of my art.
But
my breath was smelling good, though.
Yeah, but you got ants in your mouth.
I kissed them up to God in my head, though. You know what I'm saying? So, that was kind of nasty. But I did it. Because I wanted, I'm not a reoccurring character. So my thing was, I'm going to make this work. We need to move on. Okay,
let's move on.
Okay. All right, so then, so I'm out here grinding, man. We grinding in the cold, getting home, wee hours, in the name of art, man. It's what we do. We don't complain. You know what I mean? And then the next day, I was back on the set with Laird, TV series called Laird, and I play a character called Street Dude.
Okay.
So I got my 1990s Gazelles on.
Okay.
I got my fitted baseball hat. I got my Run DMC gold chain on.
Yeah.
I got my sweat top. My Tim's on, And it's kind of comedic. It's real, real funny. So, I can't wait to see what that's going to look like. But
wow.
We're staying on the grind, man. Got a couple nice. Auditions coming up.
Yeah, we do.
We always got some auditions coming up. So that was me. So
okay.
What about you?
Well, I got my script. I got my script from, remember the Temple student somebody was telling you about? I got my script for that.
Okay.
So I'm going over that. And, you know, we had to make some quick adjustments,
mm-hmm.
you know, this week, you know. But guess what? It's all good.
It's all good.
It's all good.
It's all good.
So, you know, that's how I go in acting.
That's how I go in acting.
We got to be quick on our feet.
You got to be
things
quick
happen,
with this.
You know,
yep.
So
that's
going
it.
Over my script. And I also applied for a few things that I'm waiting down, you know, to come down the pipes. And you applied for some stuff.
Yeah.
We're both waiting for some things.
Absolutely.
You know, we're both getting some things. So, yep.
Yeah.
The client
hey.
Does not sleep.
And
it
you forgot you forgot to tell them you got cast for ID Channel.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
oh,
you got cast for ID Channel.
And that's up in New York.
Up in New York,
that's
National
TV.
That's
up in New York.
Yep.
And I will be playing a grand. I'm so glad you said it because
yeah.
I completely forgot. I will be playing a grandmother, so they're going to age me.
Right,
again,
right.
Remember?
Yep.
This is my third time being aged. Now, remember I told you that for the Temple film, they're going to age me. I had to send a picture, and I also had to send a voiceover over to the casting director. She said, I need to hear you sound
mm-hmm.
like a senior citizen, like an old lady. So
give us a taste. Don't take us to the don't take us to the water. Don't take us to the mountain.
What do senior citizens like to do? They like to pray. So
okay.
I sent her a prayer.
Come on, give us a little bit. Just give us a couple lines real quick. Come on, Nick, give us a couple lines.
I'm just going to
give us a little bit.
I'm just going
to. You sound like a senior citizen right now. Come on.
All right, what I said, now see, you're making me do I'm going to laugh.
All right,
what I said was, I said, what did I say?
You probably said, Lord Jesus.
No, I said, Heavenly Father and our God.
That's it, right, bitch.
We thank you, Lord, for everything that you have done for us. And they, when
you
I.
You sound like a slave. But anyway, you're going to get cast for that.
Was
that was
way,
good.
Was,
that was good.
Listen, it was way better than that.
No, that was good. What you gave us was good.
They loved it, and they cast me for the role. As you see, I got the part.
I got the part.
Because yeah. Now they're saying that they're going to age me now to fit the voice to go
right,
with
right,
it.
Right,
so,
right, right.
Man,
that's
I must
great.
Have did that recording like 10 times just trying to get it right.
But that's what we do, man. I mean, before you send it in, you want that thing to be right.
Yeah, because the casting director said, well, you know, you sound like a 25-year-old, how this is going to work? I said, well, let me send you a recording in, like, a senior voice. So I recorded it. She said, oh, my God, I loved it.
Yeah.
And so when
good.
The email came over, the email said, we loved it. Like,
I got
yes.
you. I got you. You get. So, I mean, what you gave our listeners, we thought that was great.
Yeah.
I mean, that was great. So if it was anything close
well,
to
I
that.
I did much better than that, but you were making me laugh.
No, so. I know. But you did sound like a slave, though. You sound like a slave, like a slave narrative, not a senior citizen.
Well,
but,
we're still waiting on that. Time,
right, right. We're still waiting on
we're
that.
We're still waiting
keeping
on that.
Keeping hope alive, man.
Keeping hope alive on that.
Yeah.
So,
yeah, the adventures continue, man.
Yeah.
We always seem like we got something going on.
Yeah.
Something coming up. And so, yeah, we are going to take a break.
Yes.
And
when we come back,
we're going to introduce to you.
They ain't ready.
They ain't going to be ready for
that. They're not ready for that.
We got a special guest. And all our guests are special.
Yep.
But
yeah.
He kind of special.
Mm.
Kevin and Nikki Show.
Get into you. Don't try to find.
And we are back.
Yes, yes, yes. It's the Kevin and Nikki show on iHeartRadio.
Yeah, man.
Michael Jackson is my man. Let me tell you.
Yeah,
let me tell you, you cannot go wrong with Michael Jackson.
You sure
every
can.
Every single song that he has is a hit. I don't care what it is. Just like Prince, every single song that Prince has is a hit.
Is a hit.
And you cannot dance. You cannot not dance on a Michael Jackson song nor Prince.
Wait,
so,
you know, not is a double negative and making a positive. Right, so it makes you dance.
What?
That's my analytical
mind. Okay.
I'm just
analyzing
stuff. All
right,
no, but you're right, though. There's no way you can listen to that song.
No way
and
you
not,
listen to that
and
song.
Not get up and start,
and not get up
and start boogieing. Yeah, man. There's no way. Mike is the man.
He is.
He definitely is the
he
man.
Is. He is.
He definitely.
How do you like my old lady voice?
Oh, I thought it was great. I thought the old lady voice was great. And I can see why you got cast, man. You know, ID channel. That's national TV. You know what I'm saying?
The recording, though. The recording was crazy because I even cracked a joke while I was praying. You know how senior citizens be cracking jokes
mm-hmm.
while they're praying.
Okay.
I even did that.
Oh, man.
I almost messed up, made myself laugh.
Right.
During the recording. But after I pushed stop, I bust out laughing.
Mm.
I said something about I'm going to take better care of Lucius or Buddy or something I said.
Mm-hmm.
And I said, I'm sorry about giving him the medicine the way I did, but he didn't want to take it, so I had to shove it down his throat. I said that in the prayer.
Oh, my goodness. You're going to be praying for people.
I know.
You got acts of violence in your prayer. But
listen, but you know how seniors be when they be trying to pray,
yep.
And they be saying a whole bunch of nonsense.
I got
they praying.
They do. They be battling
yeah.
on. Yeah.
So,
oh, yo, we don't want to waste no more time. We want to bring our very, 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 very special guest, D. Cobb, Garry Cobb.
Yes.
And we're gonna get into his extensive.
I'm a fan.
I'm gonna tell you right now, I'm a huge fan.
Yes,
yeah.
I'm so
yeah.
excited.
D. Cobb, are you there?
I'm right here.
Oh,
how
man.
You doing?
Yes. And listen, man, we are very, very honored, and I mean it in every sense of the word, to have you as a guest on the show. Thank you for taking time out of your busy schedule. And we want to jump right on in, man. You're the man of the hour right now, and we want to get right on into it. You played for the Detroit Pistons,
mm-hmm.
not for Detroit Lions, I'm sorry.
Yes.
You played for, of course, the Philadelphia Eagles, and you played for the Dallas Cowboys. Now, we're going to leave the Cowboys part off right now.
That's fine. I understand.
Yeah. But you do an exceptional job analyzing football. You're an analyst for the Philadelphia Eagles. You know, you've been on 610 WIP, All Sports Radio, and I used to listen to you all the time. Give us why is the Eagles right now the hottest team in the NFL? Offensively, defensively, give us your spiel.
Well, you know, I think that there's certain things that have been happening with the Eagles. There's been a maturity process that's happened with a number of their young players. You know, I was just talking to Brian Dawkins a couple days ago, and Brian was talking, and he I guess he was inspired, and he just started talking about, you know, what's happening on the team because, you know, he's working in the front office and things. And so we got a chance to talk. But and I was sharing some things with him that certain players had told me.
Mm-hmm.
But the big thing that's happening is, first of all, you've got a team that's thinking about winning.
Right.
And that's the number one goal. It's not about just building up stats and guys doing things individually. As a team, they're thinking about what does it take to win. And
mm-hmm.
Quite a few of these players who haven't had the success in their career up till now, they hadn't had the success they wanted.
Mm-hmm.
They really, readdressed some things and decided, hey, they were going to do certain things to get better and working. And everybody's trying to take their game to the next level. That's why you got a team that works very hard there. Very focused. They realize mm-hmm. the importance of the mental part of the game. You're not just playing physically. And a lot of the guys have had an attitude where they want to learn. And they're willing to be coached.
Right.
So you could be corrected and not take it personally and realize, look, he's just trying to make me better. He's just trying to help me get better. So that attitude has permeated the team, mostly because Carson Wentz has got that kind of attitude.
When your
most important player has that type of attitude, it allows other people to have that attitude. And then when Doug Peterson came in, he did a great job of going to the leaders on the team, like Malcolm Jenkins, you know, like Rodney McLeod and like Fletcher Cox and having those guys and Jason Peters and letting your better players and, you know, accomplished guys be leaders and have a stake in the team. That means they can come to him and say, "Coach, I got an idea. I think that, you know, what do you think if we did this?" Whatever, you know. So you got a back and forth. You don't have the coach just telling everybody what to do. Now, when I played, the coach told us what to do. Rarely would you have the time where you're coming in and you're giving your feedback and everything. But now it's a different player. It's a different time. You know, the country is different. The world's different, you know. So Doug has, you know, he's made adjustments. And all of that is coming together at a good time. And really, though, a lot of it has to do with the character of the players, to where you've got guys that are mature enough where they don't want to waste their career. They don't want to waste this year. So they want to focus on, what do we need to do to win?
Right.
You know, coach, what do we need to do to win? And guys have been willing to put the time in, make the commitment, to work during the offseason and everything. They just have done everything the right way, and it's fallen into place. And the people they brought in, they've done a good job of bringing in the right people with the right type of character. It's fit together, and they're rolling. So that's the reason for it. You know, they've made a point to really watch the people they brought in, and they brought in the right people.
Yeah, and you know that you can see that permeate onto the field when you watch them play, and it looks like they're having fun. I mean, you know, they're doing end zone celebrations as a team.
Yeah,
and it just looks like they're having fun.
Yeah, they're doing a great job. Yeah. I will say they are. They're doing a really good job.
Yeah. Now you played linebacker, so you are no stranger to defensive schemes, as well as the whole totality of the game. You played alongside Hall of Famer Reggie White, and you also played in Buddy Ryan's swarming defense. It seemed like nobody could get nothing past you guys, and I say y'all should have won the Super Bowl.
Mm-hmm.
But from a defensive perspective, what is the Eagles team doing defensively that's giving them so much success? Because I mean, they're like putting so many limitations on other offenses that it's just setting them apart from the rest of the league.
Well, the first thing they do is their defensive line is on the attack.
Okay.
They are not waiting at the line of scrimmage. They're not trying to be careful about stuff. First thing they're doing is flying off the ball and trying to get into your backfield. And a lot of times they're making plays on the opposite side of the ball. You know, they don't even want to give the guy a chance to get out of the backfield. If you're going to run the ball, they're on the attack. Now, really what they do is the mentality is play the run on the way to the quarterback, meaning we're trying to get to the quarterback, but we're playing the run in the process. So you hand the ball off, and I'm running into the backfield, then I'm going to make sure I'm not running by the ball carrier. If he's got the ball, I'm busting it, you know. So they're on the attack. The linebacker's job is basically to clean up whatever's left, meaning if the back is able to get through there, the linebacker's got to make the play. But the defensive line wants to create chaos. They want anybody, you know, the guy's trying to block him, they want to get in the backfield and mess up the timing and make the running back have to cut back, or he's got to change his direction. They want to create chaos. So they're trying to get into the backfield, and they're going to just destroy whatever's in their path. And they do it wisely, though. They know the different formations to know what play. They like to run out of a certain formation. So they're going to be ready for that play. But the big thing they're doing is they want, you know, just total chaos in the backfield. Because usually, as a defensive player, if you mess up and destroy things that are in your way, you know, you're going to mess things up for the offense. You know, they got to have a timing. You know, the defensive line wants to destroy any timing. You know, they want the their offensive linemen to be able to pull. And if they're trying to pull, a lot of times they're going to run into the defensive tackle because they're blowing into the backfield and everything. So they just want to create chaos, and they're doing a great job of that. And one of the big problems offenses have is because of Tim Jernigan and the way he's been playing, when they try to double Fletcher, then Jernigan's one-on-one. And a lot of times Jernigan's creating problems when he's left one-on-one. So they're in a quandary like, well, which one of these guys do we need to double? We can't double both of them.
So, right, pick your poison. Yep.
You got to pick your poison. And so, you know, and they're getting into the backfield. And a lot of times what happens is if it's a play-action pass, then they're already flying in the backfield. So the quarterback's not going to have very much time. He's got to get rid of that ball. And it's of course, creates problems for the wide receivers because they don't have time to run their route. The quarterback is always under duress. He's never comfortable. There's somebody in his face, and if they're not all the way in his face, they got their hands up and they're knocking down the ball. Or, you know, it's just not a comfortable situation for a quarterback or the running back to play against the Eagles because they got those defensive line in the backfield all the time. And then the linebackers, who, you know, the numerous times I've had talks with Michael Kendricks, who wanted to play more and everything, and I was explaining to him, look, what you got to do is when you get on the field, you got to play so well, they're going like, we cannot take this guy off the field. You know?
That's right.
And he is doing that. I mean, he is showing, he's had, you know, he wants to prove to people that he's one of the better linebackers in the league. And, you know, he's doing a good job of it. He's definitely taking that, you know, the emotion and putting it into his play. And and they're doing that. So there's so many things coming together, and I can't say enough about the cornerbacks. We know the quality of the safeties. They got two of the best safeties in the game, and Malcolm Jenkins and Rodney McLeod. So the corners, though, they have come around, and I see a lot of where you got Malcolm and Rodney working with the corners, explaining to them what to look out for, what route they're going to run on certain situations. So the corners are getting all their experience, and, you know, they're playing smarter. They know what route they're going to run when a wide receiver lines up at a certain spot and he's got a certain formation and it's a certain down and distance. So you got Jalen Mills and Rasul Douglas and Patrick Robinson and all the guys playing out there. They're playing smarter. They're playing thinking man's football, and that's happening throughout the team. Where you just got a smart football team. These guys stay late and look at tape. They go to each other's houses and look at tape together and everything. And they're putting in the work, and they're putting in long hours. But when Sunday comes, you're glad you put in that time because they're ready for the other team, and they've been out preparing teams and if they continue, you know, they're going to be holding up that trophy because they definitely are, you know, playing as well as anybody in the league. So we'll see if they can continue it.
Right, right. Yeah, talk a little bit about you already made mention of Carson Wentz. He is the general of that offense. And, I mean, I'm just very, very impressed with his maturity in just 2 years. And in my, you know, opinion, he's playing like an MVP candidate at a minimum. And what do you attribute to his growth and development, and what is his impact on that offense?
Well, he's had an enormous impact on the offense. You know, and mainly, you know, I'll just start with the third down. You know, third down, they call that the money down in the NFL. Third down, that's the money down. Because people that play on third down and make plays on third down, they get paid because it's the key to the game. If you convert a third down and you get the first down, then you keep the ball. You know, you keep the ball, you keep the other team's offense off the field, and eventually you keep doing that. Eventually the referee's raising his hands because it's touchdown, you know, because you're continuing to drive the ball. So third down is the money down. And there's been nobody better, not a quarterback better in the league. Even Tom Brady hasn't been as effective as Carson Wentz has been on third down. And remember, that's the money down. So he's been able to extend plays on third down. He's been able to run for third, first down to extend drives. He knows which guy to go to. He's been, you know, very accurate on third down. He's made big plays where long touchdowns on third down. You know, he's just been everything when it comes to third down. And he said, and from talking to him, that he spent more time working on third down. Last year, he knew he needed to improve on third down. So during the offseason, he would spend days just working on third down, And he's gained a rapport with guys like, you know, Zach Ertz, who's probably he's more in sync with Zach Ertz than any other receiver. And so they see everything the same way. If they see a coverage, they know what they're going to do. Zach knows what route he's going to run. He knows where the ball's going to be. He knows how to set up the defender. And that's the same thing in the red zone, which is also money time. Because, you know, if you're scoring touchdowns rather than field goals, you know, you're playing during the postseason. The people that are kicking field goals, they got an early offseason, you know.
As Charles Barkley was saying, and Kenny Smith, they're going fishing, man.
That's right. That's exactly what it is. So Carson is he's been clutch. You know, when they've had some close games, which they haven't had but so many, he's played well down the stretch. You know, and that's what you need out of your quarterback. You know, you need him to step up his play in those key times, and he has done that. And, you know, just been a great leader for the team, too, because of his unselfishness and being positive. And he's been able to bring everything together, and he's got the guys playing together and, you know, putting in the time in preparation because he's the first one there in the morning at 5:30 or 6 o'clock every morning. And, you know, when you see your best player putting in the time, and see, this is the situation they got up in New England.
Right.
When Tom Brady's going to go out and do some running, you can't jump up and leave going like, look, this is the best player. This guy's a Hall of Famer. If he's willing to get in there early and put in the time, you better be doing your job. And so everybody knows. And so Carson has set that bar high for this team. See?
That's right.
And so everybody's working. There's no selfishness about how many times I carried the ball or how many passes came to me in that. If Carson's not thinking about his stats, then nobody in that building has a reason to be thinking about their stats. So it's been a tremendous ride so far. And I don't see why, they got to be the team that I expect to be coming out of the NFC, you know.
Okay. So, yeah.
Good times. Yep.
And that was going to be my next question. You know, with the New Orleans Saints playing well, maybe not as well as the Eagles. Then you got the Vikings. Do you feel or think that the Eagles could be hosting that Lombardi Trophy at the end of the season?
Well, that could definitely be the case because. See, the things that make up a championship team, first of all, you got to be able to run the football. You know, you don't want to be one-dimensional where you got to throw the ball all the time. You can't let a team take away your running game. Now, the Eagles have run the ball on just about everybody, you know, and they have not allowed teams to run the ball on them.
That's one prerequisite.
Of most championship teams is they're great against the run, and they can run the ball on you. So right away, they're putting pressure on your quarterback because he's got to throw more than he wants to, and he doesn't. He can't run play action pass, so you're able to really get after the other team's quarterback. But because you can run, they really can't get after your quarterback right there. They got to be really cautious about run fakes because you got a good running game. So they have that. And then the key thing is, you got a good defense and you got a quarterback who can get it done in crunch time. You know, that's
absolutely.
And they've got all those items. So they definitely are one of the Super Bowl favorites right now.
I hear you.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, you know, I want to switch gears a little bit. First of all, let me say, I truly enjoy watching you on Fox 29.
Thank you.
When you come
on
and talk sports, the way you guys go back and forth is hilarious. And I crack it every time. Every time you start talking, I know it's going to be super funny because you are so passionate about sports.
Uh-huh.
But I want to talk a little bit about your book. You wrote a book, Don't Be Clueless, and that book pretty much was geared towards teenagers and adults and pretty much helping them to chase their dreams. Talk a little bit about your book, Don't Be Clueless.
Well, the book was about, you know, really like the fundamentals of success, really kind of, for somebody that's growing up. That's pretty much what that book was for, meaning that there's certain things, like, first of all, you know, you got to feel good about yourself. You've got to know what your strengths and your weaknesses are, and then you've got to be willing to work. You know, that's some of the things. If you want to be, have a successful career, you know, you got to identify what you do well, and then you've got to be willing to develop and perfect your craft. And that's work. That takes work. That takes commitment to time and that sort of thing. And you got to be willing, you know, and feel good about yourself, the way you can go out and go after your dream, you know. So
right.
That's basically, you know, some of the things in that book. It basically deals with a lot of the fundamentals of being a caring and respectful and adult. People look at it and say, you know, I like some of the things about that person. I definitely would like to emulate, you know, some of the qualities they have. I try to communicate in that book.
That's so powerful. So if people wanted to get a copy of your book, like, how can they purchase a copy of your book? That information out there.
Yeah, you could go on Amazon. If you Google the book, Don't Be Clueless, it's available on Amazon. You can go on there and click on it and boom, and order it. And you probably could get it this afternoon.
Okay, cool. Yeah, and that's just so neat. Our young people, you know, we live in a generation where a lot of our young people, you know, don't have goals, dreams, aspirations. You know, they can't see past their neighborhood, the situation and circumstance that they're facing. So I want to definitely encourage young people and adults, get a copy of this book. I can assure you it's going to be great. I'm going to get a copy as well just to support and because I got dreams. I still got dreams.
Right,
Nick
right.
got dreams. So we just going to let G-Con's book reinforce our dreams. Yeah. So, you know.
I hear you.
Yes. Well, and you, I also see that in 2002, you were honored by President Bush for working with troubled youth. Tell us a little bit about that.
Well, what I do now is I have church. I go to Living Faith Christian Center, which is a church over in Pennsauken, New Jersey. And I'm in charge of the prison ministry. So what we do is we go to a youth facility, which has got about 1,800 youngsters. And basically I'm talking about a lot of things I just shared with you. I'm talking about work ethic. I'm talking about, you know, goal setting. You know, I'm talking about, you know, going after excellence, you know, pursuing excellence. And I'm talking about, you know, different things like that on a daily basis, you know, and being an honorable person, you know. Of course, you know, I share about, you know, having a relationship with the Lord and knowing that, you know, God created you for a purpose. You know, you're not just here by accident. There's a reason you're here. And you want to make sure you impact people because of the way you live, that people are watching you, and you definitely have an influence on people. You can encourage people, and just by them being in your company, you can lift up their eyes to where they can see that they are capable of doing more, and they can pursue excellence, especially when they see you pursuing excellence. You know that.
That's right.
You know, for people to see you go through. You know, put a goal out there and go after it, and that you're just not going through the motions in life. It definitely is something that wears off on you. You know, and I have, you know, my parents are still living. They're up in their 80s. And, you know, I was raised by two people. I have all the respect in the world for my parents because, you know, Well, when they were young, you know, they dropped out of school. They would grow up in the South, and they were working in the farm, and education wasn't valued a lot. But my dad went to the Army, and while in the Army, he saw that the soldiers that were promoted to higher ranks were the ones with an education. So he saw the value of getting an education, and we didn't know it, but he was committing that all his kids were going to get an education. So he would get in our face and kind of, look, I'll tell you what, I don't know what your friends are going to do and everybody else at that school is going to do, but I tell you what, you're going to get an education.
Mm-hmm. That's right.
So he would let us know, and he would encourage us. And my mom was more the encourager and everything. My dad was the disciplinarian. And, you know, they worked with us. And I tell you, you know, my parents, we always knew they were cared about. You know, my dad was always there, always a big part of my life and still now. And so, you know, that's affected me. And I see how important it is that one of the biggest challenges in our communities is we need men fathering and mentoring and loving on our young men that are growing up. You know,
a young man needs somebody that
knows that they care about them, but at the same time, somebody that will tell them about boundaries and things they need to do and things they don't need to do, and somebody to discipline them and care about them and love them. You know, young men need that. And when the young men don't do that, then you have crime problems. You're going to have different things. So, that's what I try to communicate to the youngsters in the, this is Garden State Youth Facility up in Bordentown, New Jersey, that we work at, go to every Tuesday and work with the youngsters.
Yeah.
And, you know, I find myself doing the same thing because I also work for the NFL, where I work with young players who either are still in the league or they're out of the league. And I will work with them on different things with regards to, you know, their financial lives and making sure that they're disciplined about their spending and, you know, developing relationships with their wives and you know, all the things that go into being a man, you know, a real man, you know, that.
I got you. I'm glad you added that.
Yes.
Real man.
Yeah.
That's very important.
Yeah, because manhood is so misconstrued by the world's perspective about being macho and trying to be in control and things like that. And we were so happy that you, when you said being a real man.
A real man.
And G. Cobb, man, you are definitely a model for everything you're saying right now.
Yes.
Because in order to teach it to others, like, you can't give what you don't have.
Right.
And it's a testament to what, you know, your mom and dad put in you, and you're putting it into others, and that's how it should go. And you know, I remember I had the chance, I first met you down at the Youth Study Center down in Philadelphia, and he was taking time out of his busy schedule to come on the floor and sit among the, you know, the juvenile detained youth and talking about the principles of life and what it means to be a real man and coming up with a plan to get your life together.
And that's important. We need more of that. We need more people like Garry Cobb, you, me, you know, talking to our youngsters, teaching them how to, you know, be a man, be a woman. We need more of that.
And being the example in front of them.
Exactly,
Absolutely.
It really is what life is all about, really, you know. And I was fortunate, as I said, you know, with my my grandfather and my father and everything, you know, spending that time with myself and my brothers and sisters. And so it's only right that I pass it on, you know, and because, you know, you can see youngsters go so far when they get, you know, they need to be taught boundaries, certain things you shouldn't be saying to certain people. You know, you need to have respect for the people that are taking care of you, that are, you know, wiping your behind when you couldn't wipe it yourself.
Very important.
Yeah.
You always respect those
That's
people.
Right.
Now, you don't have to agree with everything they say, and, you know, that's not the thing. But the thing is, as long as you're in their house, you're living in the house.
Yes.
They are the ones in charge. You know, just like
that's
I said.
Right. That's right.
Look, if you're working at somebody's job, you're not the boss.
That's
you know
right.
I mean? You're working with. They are the boss. Now that gives you incentive to where if you don't like the way they're doing something, you can go start your own company.
That's right.
You know, and so you know, there are boundaries, and you know, there's a certain respect, and so I always you know, let youngsters know that. That way, they know these boundaries, and then they know, hey, look, we care about you. This is not just you know, a temporary thing. That if I have a relationship with you, then I got a relationship with you the rest of our lives. You know.
That's right.
It's not where this is a temporary thing, and so long-term relationships, you know, healthy relationships, encouraging, supportive relationships. That's what we need for so many young men, you know. And I'm not slighting the young women, but our young men, we're losing so many of our young men that we definitely you know, need to tighten up things there. That's why every chance I get to spend some time with a young man, I know how important it is, because I know that he's going to wind up being somebody's father.
That's right.
Yeah.
And, you know, what kind of man he is going to have a lot to do with what kind of person they are. So,
that's right.
You know,
is so true.
And you're not slighting the woman, as you say. It's really, in essence, you're giving a call to us as men to step up.
Exactly.
That's it.
You know, and we got to step up in our homes, in the community, mm-hmm, in the church, mm-hmm, you know, on mm-hmm our jobs. And that's really what you're speaking to the essence of.
That's it.
Absolutely. Great stuff. Great stuff. Yeah, great stuff. Yeah. So I had a chance to meet you down at the Youth Study Center. And mm-hmm, do you still do ministry down at the Youth Study Center?
I still go on there. I don't go down there as much because I'm more, you know, centered over in Bordentown, but I still do, and I work with the chaplain down there, cause, you know, and I'll come in a few times a year and talk to youngsters in mass in a big assembly and get a chance to talk to them. But, you know, I do speaking because I love going into the schools and talking to youngsters, because we are shaping our future by, you know, shaping the minds and attitudes of the youngsters. You know, if they feel good about themselves, you know, they're going to be healthy and supportive to other people if they feel good about themselves. So it's very important that the youngsters are not, their feeling about themselves are not tarnished, and they come out, you know, disliking themselves, because they end up taking it out on somebody else. So, you know, having a healthy mindset, a healthy, loving mindset is just good for our community and everything, especially when it comes to men. Because if the men have a good, healthy mindset, then, you know, because certain things women aren't going to do. You know, it's going to be men. I mean, you know, you look at the crime level, it's not women doing it. It's young men don't feel good about themselves, haven't been fathered, nobody's been loving them and encouraging them, and they get lost, and then they wind up in crime. And so, you know, in order to prevent that, we need good fathers and good mentors and men that will direct and guide young men. That's the key. And the earlier we start off with them, the better. You know.
That's right.
Right. Now, real quick, I want to talk a little bit about faith. As you mentioned before, you know, you are a believer of God, and you're a father, mm-hmm, you're a husband. Talk a little bit about how faith plays an important part in your career, in your home, with your marriage. Talk a little bit about that.
Well, you know, the thing about faith is, you know, I believe that, you know, God created us, you know, and he created us with a purpose. Mm-hmm. And, you know, I have a commitment to him. And, you know, it all starts with my relationship with him, you know. And God has blessed me so much and blessed us so much and that, you know, ultimately the truth is that that Jesus paid the price for our sin. That even though we've made mistakes and continue to make mistakes, that, you know, that because of the shed blood that he made and the sacrifice he made, that we have forgiveness and that God loves us. You know, God cares about us, that God is a good God. And so I believe that he's, you know, blessed me with abilities, mm-hmm, and will bless things I get involved in, you know, as long as I am, you know, doing things that I should be doing. you know, and a lot of times it means, you know, helping other people. And I believe that as, if you do sow out good, that good will return, you know, that's
right.
a rule, that's a law. And so,
that's right.
You know, I know that as a husband, that I believe, you know, that a lot of times, you know, the thing about man is a real man has got courage.
That's
and
right.
So that means that if my wife and I are having an argument or something's not going right, it is on my part to be the man of courage
mm-hmm.
that would, you know, put the sword down, you know.
Right, right.
And so I think when you have men of courage, and so I, you know, I endeavor to be a man of courage to
that's
say
right.
things when maybe it wasn't popular to say it, but it's right.
Right.
And so
absolutely.
That means that starts at home to do what's right, you know, to honor my wife,
mm-hmm.
you know, as a woman, treat her, you know, with value, and the same thing with my kids, to know, look, you're valued, that everybody in this house, you are valued. And
that's
the way
right.
that I treat them and the way that I honor them, it sticks, because as a man, there's a certain power that a man has and a certain blessing that he has, that he's able to give that honor to his wife, to
mm-hmm.
let her know that, you know, she is precious. And then she's able to sow the gifts she has back to me and to our children, you know. And so there's kind of a glow, and it's really God's presence in the home when people are loved and cared about and valued, you know, because that's the way God looks at us. And so
right.
that's his presence and his love. And really, you know, we need more of it, you know.
That's right.
Able to say a kind word to somebody, you know, it could be at home when we get up, you know. It's really, you know, God's love is being shared, being shared. And so that's the number one thing as a man is that we're supposed to be loving, you know, our wives and loving our children. And so they need to know, look, if the sun don't come up and everything, you know, I know my husband loves me, and I know that my father loves me, you know.
That's right.
And that consistency, it's really a nurturing thing that is just healthy for everybody, you know. And so that's something that the man has to give by being able to have a gentle touch with the people in my life. So
right.
That is something that, unfortunately, a lot of men don't know that is the key to being a man. You know,
yeah.
it's not something that's missing. It's a key because it sets you apart. And
right.
I know I have, you know, being in a grocery store and to help a lady do something, what she's trying to get through, and I see that it's hard for me to get rid of her, you know, going like this.
you just thought of something now.
Well, yeah, because... You know,
yeah.
and it's unfortunate that people are not used to having somebody show that, hey, I'm valuable, that I have a
right,
value.
Right,
right.
People are so hungry for it.
Yeah.
They're so hungry for it that if anybody shows it to them, you know, they're ready to attach to you. And, you know, like this, you want to.
That's right, that's right.
Whoa, don't take this the wrong way. I got to go.
I'm just helping you with your bags. That's it.
That's right. That's all it is,
that's right.
you know.
That's
because,
right.
You know, and so it's something that has just, common sense, unfortunately, is not always common.
That's right.
Right.
That's
right.
Right.
That's right.
Unfortunately.
That's right. And, I mean, I'm just so blessed to hear you. I've been blessed to hear you speak on numerous occasions. I mean, you came and spoke at the Church of Redeemers one day, all day youth retreat. I've been blessed by hearing you speak now, because it's going to take more of us as men to take on the courage to talk about what it means
mm-hmm.
to be a real man, not the
yes.
world's perception
yes.
of what it means to be a man, materialism, you know, all kinds of, you know, behaviors that are dysfunctional and not in line with love and building up people and family and children. And so, yes, and Jesus was a man of courage. He stood alone. Then he had his 12, but he primarily stood alone. And he went
mm-hmm.
against
mm-hmm.
the grain of the culture. And,
right.
you know, the culture of that time, which was worldly and carnal. And so it's just so refreshing, man, just to hear, you know, a man of God,
yes,
letting people know what it means to be a real man. You know,
and some of the things have been, and you guys are tapping into some of it, which is things have been distorted. You know,
yeah.
And of course, one of the things that has been distorted is sex. You
that's
know,
right.
You know, yeah, where it's the kind of thing, and, you know, and I used to see guys, and, you know, when I was growing up, you know, hear them talking about things where, you know, a real man, you know, is a player. You know, the woman,
right, right, right.
Three and four and five women, you know.
Yeah.
And you're lying to all of them, and, you know, and you do.
He said, so.
Every last one.
You're lying to all of them.
That was the whole thing, and unfortunately, you got a lot of young men that have that as an image of a real man.
Right.
And really, if, you know, the real deep and loving things, whether it be really having a good time sexually and everything, it takes time. You know, it takes time to where a husband and a wife to really get to a point where they know each other, they're able to open up to each other, you know, emotionally. It's when they're going to have the best time sexually, you know.
Right,
and,
that's right.
And, you know, somebody that really knows a woman to where when you really, you know that you're in a safe place.
Right.
To where it's a secure place. Well, that's when, you know, a man would know that, look, this is the kind of situation where you're really going to get to know the best parts and the deepest places in that woman to where you're really going to be able to enjoy your sex life with her, you know. So, you know, and unfortunately, people think that that's going to be something that's just done where you run here and run there. No, you know, that is not where you really get fulfilled as a person. You know, it doesn't happen with something that just happens overnight. It's something that is done where you make a commitment and you put your life into, that's when you get, you know, a serious return from it. So,
Absolutely. That's a lot of great information. Well, G. Cobb, man, I'm soaking all this in. So blessed. You're so blessed to have you.
So blessed.
I know our listeners are too. We have to wrap up the interview, but before we go, people may want to know how to follow you on social media, on Twitter, Instagram, if you want to put your social media handles out there so people can follow you and your sports commentating and things like that. We want to give you that opportunity.
Well, if you'd like to follow me, of course, I'm on Twitter at Garry Cobb, and the key is the two R's in Garry. It's at Garry Cobb, G-A-R-R-Y, last name is C-O-B-B, at Garry Cobb. You could follow me on Twitter there. You could also follow me on Facebook at gcobb.com. I have a website, gcobb.com. And also, you can follow me on Instagram at Garry Cobb. It's two R's. That's the key, at garycobb.com. And get a chance to follow me because I'm always up at the Eagles practices and around the team, and I get a chance to talk to the guys and everything. So I have a good relationships with all the players. And so I've kind of seen this team grow, and that's why it's amazing to see the maturity and the growth that's happened with the football team. And, you know, I have a lot of favorite guys up there. I mean, there are a lot of really good people. I mean, I love those guys on the team, and they have some quality young men that I take my hat off to. You know, a young man like Brandon Graham, who didn't grow up in the best situations. He just blossomed into such an outstanding young man, you know, both as a husband and as a father. And you just see certain things, you know, growing in him. You notice, you know what, this is an outstanding young man. Not to mention a great football player, but he's just an outstanding young man. And I could talk about so many of the guys on the team. And you know, I get a chance to spend time with them and everything, but they just got a lot of quality people on the football team. So I'm available, and I'll love to hear from you guys, like I said, on Twitter and Facebook and Instagram and all that.
All right.
Awesome.
Look, thank you so much. And listen, we fans of yours. You already knew that.
You already know. I'm a huge fan.
Absolutely, man. thank you so much for coming on the show.
Yes.
We definitely got to have you back. Man, you was kind of turning into Dr. Phil for a minute there, man.
I love it. I love it.
Well, you know, really, you know, I work for the NFL, and I wind up doing some Dr. Phil things because I have to work with players and their families
okay.
and things. So, you know, I end up doing some Dr. Phil things. So.
Okay. Well, great. Well,
thank
look,
so
continue success to you, man. Of course, we're going to continue to follow you and listen to you. And we want to definitely get you back.
Thank you so much.
All right.
Yeah,
God bless you. It was a pleasure.
God bless.
All right.
Thank
God bless you.
God bless you.
All right. All right. Bye-bye.
Bye. Well, that was awesome.
That was awesome, wasn't it?
I mean, yes.
That was
that
powerful.
Was awesome.
That was powerful.
I didn't say much because I was too busy soaking it all in and listening because that was like.
Yeah. That was
he
powerful.
Ran out with so much knowledge.
He dropped a lot on.
He dropped a lot on you men.
Yeah, he did. He did, and I received it. I received it.
He dropped a lot on
yeah.
you men.
He sure
you know,
did. We got to step up, man.
He was letting y'all know. That's why I was quiet.
Right, right.
He was letting y'all know. Y'all got to step
we
up.
Gotta step it up.
You got to stop running from woman to woman and having babies by everybody. Come on.
All right, just we ain't get to what's bothering Nikki yet. All right.
Okay, okay, okay. All right, we're going to take a break.
All right, we're going to take
and
a break.
And when we come back.
When we come back. We got, what
we're
going to
have news.
We're going to have news. Oh, you get to sing this week?
I get to sing this week, right, yes, because it's not your week. Yes, this is the Kevin and Nikki Show on iHeartRadio.
We everywhere.
And we are back.
We are back. We are back.
Did you sing?
I didn't sing.
You better not.
I got a question, though.
It's not your week. No.
No, not about singing.
What?
After everything D. Cobb just said, how are we going to play Whippin' Baby? We going to hell, man.
That's what I thought.
And everything he said, we're going to play Whippin' Baby.
But wait a minute. Wait.
But,
if you listen to the lyrics.
Okay.
He said there's something divine in you.
Clean it up. Okay. Spiritualize.
There's something divine in you. I will not waste your time.
I got you.
Now. So
okay,
that
okay,
song
okay.
was appropriate.
Okay. You know, that was good.
Okay.
That was a good analogy.
Now, although the beginning of the song was crazy.
However, he
said, there is no time to lose. There's something divine in you. I won't waste your time.
Okay.
Now, so basically, he's taking ownership. He sees something in her. He's not going to waste her time. So, you know, if she talks to him, it's going to be worth it.
And he was talking about the Bible. I got you. All right.
All right.
Anyway, we back, man. Look, we just having so much fun. We having a great time. That interview was awesome. We got more than we bargained for.
That's why I was so quiet, because he was, once we got done with talking about sports and we got a little bit into his ministry.
And about life.
He was dropping it down. And like I said, I love the message that he gave out for the men. Love it. I mean, men, you got to step up. You got to step up.
I echo that. I received it.
You have to start doing your job as a man.
I got you.
And
you got
to stop running from woman to woman and lying to us all.
And we got to help the young guys. That was a major thing, too.
Because
you know
what I got from what he was saying is that the older men have to be an
example
to the younger men. Because these boys are watching you.
Right.
Now, remember,
mm-hmm.
a father has a son, right?
Mm-hmm.
Father treats the wife bad, cheats on the wife, everything. What does the son do?
The son's going to model that.
So, fathers, you got to start teaching your sons how to be a man and how to treat women.
Right, and then here's the other thing, because you have a lot of shout out to all the single moms. Now, I know some single dads that are holding it down.
Shout out
to them, too.
Mm-hmm.
But they're most of us as African Americans are hell. Homes are spearheaded by single moms.
Yes.
And so that's when we need an uncle to step up. That's when we need a church member to step up. We need somebody in the community to step up to show these young guys what's it like to be a real man.
Yeah.
Because if they don't get someone to positively define it, the streets primarily is going to define that.
Yeah.
BET is going to define it.
Yes.
You know, the world is going to define it.
Yes. And I'm going to tell you right now, some women may not like what I'm getting ready to say, but I'm going to say it. Women cannot teach a boy how to be a man.
Gotcha.
That is a man's job. That is what you are here for. You are the father.
Right.
You are supposed to teach that boy how to become a man.
That's right.
We cannot do that.
Right. But the single moms are doing the best that they can.
The best that we can.
Right. And you have a lot of people.
But, however, that's a man's job.
Got you. I agree with you.
And the father is supposed to be there. Because here's the thing,
mm-hmm.
father, men, you don't want another man teaching your son how to be a man. Because what if that man is not a good role model?
Now, check this out. I'm glad you said that, because G. Cobb talked about how he used to do prison ministry,
mm-hmm.
but he did it with the youth.
Yeah.
Now, back in the day, I used to do prison ministry with the men.
Mm-hmm.
And so we would go in and play basketball. Our church would go in and play basketball
mm-hmm.
against the inmates, and then we would kind of have a halftime session where we would talk about, you know, life and kind of the things he was talking about. I mean, we was in some major prisons, like Gratisford.
Yeah.
Trying to give them.
Oh, hold up now.
Yeah, we was in Gratisford.
Gratisford.
We went to a major.
And you still here?
And I'm still here.
Woo!
By the grace of God. Now, here's the thing,
Gratisford,
though.
Honey.
That was an experience, man, but. They showed us a lot of love. We went in there with no fear, knowing that God was with us, God was for us, and we beat them. We beat them in basketball. We like, look, we're going to show them that we can play, that we here for business, that we're not afraid. But it was that win that earned their their respect, and they listened to it. And then once they listened to it, then we had the opportunity at halftime to drop science on them. And this one guy said, man, he was like, man, listen, what you about to preach? I was like, no, nah, man, you know, I ain't about to preach. I just want to share a little word with you. No, that's all, a little encouragement, inspiration. He said, man, we don't want to hear you. Matter of fact, we want to hear, what's that preacher in Lakewood? We want to hear Joel Osteen. Matter of fact, we want you to preach like Joel Osteen. I said, man, I can't preach like Joel Osteen. You know, he's mega church, celebrity pastor. He said, man, if you don't preach like Joel Osteen, you ain't going to make it out of here. Like, I said, if you invite Christ into your life, it'll be the best decision you ever made. Amen.
You get on my nerve. You get on my nerve.
You ain't going to make it out of here. Like, if you invite Christ into your life.
Stop it. Stop playing.
Oh, man. All right, look, we got to do the news. All right, we got to do the news.
You played too.
You invite Christ into your life.
You were Joel Osteen.
Look, I became Joel Osteen real quick.
You became that real
I sure
quick.
Did.
When you turn around and
say,
whoop.
I said, God, you invite Christ into your life. For real, man. I look, I'm still here.
Well, yeah, because you were Joel.
Woo! Man, I learned real quick, didn't I? So, yeah.
What he said, you ain't going to make it out of here.
You ain't going to make it out of here. I had the accent and all. So.
You get on my nerves.
For real.
Come on, stop playing.
All right, let's stop there. Oh, we got to get to the news. All right, what's going on in the news, man?
You play too much. That's what's going on in the news.
Oh, man.
All right. So, guys, brace yourselves.
Brace yourselves.
Buckingham Palace is going to get a princess of color.
Ooh.
Princess of color is going to be walking around the White House. And let me tell you.
Not the White House.
Darn it. See, that's you. You
Buckingham. You said it.
Yes.
Okay.
Buckingham Palace is going to get a princess of color.
Wow.
And let me tell you. Everyone is so happy.
Mm-hmm.
They're happy about that to the point where England, they're tweeting about it. They are so happy. They are happy for Prince Harry.
Wow.
He and his fiance, Meghan Markle.
Mm-hmm.
Meghan has a mother. She is her mother is African American and her father is Caucasian.
I got you.
Okay. And Meghan, she's also an actress.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
But here's the thing, though.
Go, Megan.
Megan got her own money, okay?
Oh, yeah.
Listen, because when you are not a royal priesthood, they call you a commoner.
Okay, gotcha.
Okay? So, but Megan is
She's a rich commoner.
Listen.
Can I be commoner?
And everybody know, honey.
Right.
She bringing a lot to that table.
Yeah.
She ain't coming up there with nothing in it.
Right.
It is no rags to riches story because
she's bringing in the riches.
She's bringing in her own riches.
Yeah,
she's letting it be known. So, you know, everyone is happy about it.
Now, listen, I'm going to always leave room for us to be wrong, but we try to do our research and, you know, report what we can, the facts and stuff. But to my understanding, I don't think the queen was too happy about it. I don't think she's too happy about it. But Harry said, I ain't letting go.
She wasn't happy.
Yeah, queen wasn't
but,
happy.
But Harry was like, listen.
Listen, Queenie.
This,
I ain't letting go of this.
This is the woman I chose.
Right.
This is the woman I'm going to be with, and this is the woman I'm going to have my babies with.
Mm-hmm.
Okay? Love is where you find it. It is not in the color of our skin.
Mm-hmm.
Love, he loves her, she loves him, and Prince Harry's like, listen, this is going to be my woman.
That's it.
Okay?
That's it.
It's going to be my woman, and I love it. I love it. Everybody loves the idea, and that ring that he gave her. Woo. Okay.
Wow.
Yes. Wow. I'm so happy for the both of them. I really am.
Okay, cool.
And in other news, entertainment news, Kevin Hart and his wife had their baby.
Oh, shout out to my main man, Kay Hart. Congratulations, bro.
Kendall Cash Hart.
Oh, man.
Yes, was born at 1:45 a.m. He is healthy. He's smiling. And Kevin Hart tweeted, thank you all for your prayers. We love and appreciate every last one of you. And Kevin also has two children with his former wife. He has a 12-year-old and a 10-year-old with his ex-wife, Tori Hart. So now we got the Hart family.
Got the
Hart,
the Hart Foundation, man. That's
yes.
What's up. Shout out to K Hart, man. Love you, bro.
Yes, the Hart family got a little bit bigger. And I know mommy and baby, they're home, they're resting. You know, shout out to the mother, you know, and that's awesome when you have children.
Yeah.
And, you know, you get to love on them. But let me tell you this. Don't let anybody kiss on that baby.
Yeah, don't let anybody kiss on them.
No,
You don't know where people's lips been and then people don't wash their hands.
This is what you do, Kevin. You have your hand sanitizer and your wife at the door. And
that's
everybody
got
to wear gloves. White gloves that you bought.
Right,
everybody got to put them on.
Everybody got to put them on.
You know, the usher gloves.
Right, like the usher gloves.
Everybody got to put on the usher glove to hold the baby because you don't know where everybody's hands been. And everybody got to, you know, wash their face at the door.
That's right.
Wash your face at the door with those wipes. Take all that makeup off, that lipstick and everything off before you start kissing on the baby. Now everybody can't kiss the baby.
That's right. I know.
No.
That's right. Yeah. But
look at the baby through one of them things.
One little glass.
Look at the baby through the glass.
Absolutely.
You know, you keep some people away from your baby.
But, you know, we don't know where people's hot
things
are.
We don't. So, congratulations to the
Definitely congratulations, man. And we had a chance to hang out with them on the set of The Upside. Well, it was called Untouchables at that time. It's now called The Upside.
Mm-hmm.
And we got a lot of behind-the-scenes pictures, Nikki and I, with Cab. We was just backstage. Not backstage, but just behind the scenes, just busting
behind
it up.
The scenes,
and he took your phone and took a selfie with us. Harry was real, real nice. You know, one of the people that works on the team. You know, it was fun, man.
That was an awesome set to be on.
Yeah,
you know, it was cold though.
It was cold. Yeah, because it was snow. It was a storm that day, and we, like the soldiers that we are. We trudged through the snow and we was on set.
It was cold, man.
It was cold.
Yeah, but we had fun. The food was good.
The food was great.
It was really good.
All right, so we're gonna take a break.
And when we come back,
you're gonna find out
what's bothering Nikki. Yeah, because this is bothering me right here, y'all. Y'all, wait till you hear this.
Bob the Bumper. ain't got nothing on me. I'm lifting 5'1", 100 pounds of fun. I like sophisticated funk. I live on dog, her young, heavy, I'm feeling mignon. And you can best believe that's funk. Here's what I'm talking about. Swamming. I've been called Casper, show me a little bit. But some they call me Vanilla Child. But you know that don't mean my world to me. Cause baby, name can't cramp my style. I love chicken again.
We're back. It's that time of the show that I look forward to. It's time for What's Bothering Nikki. What's bothering you, Nick?
All right. Here goes. What's bothering me is this. What do you want me to do? Whatever she says goes is her house.
Oh, my. Here we go. Break it down for me, Nick.
I'm going to say it again. What do you want me to do? Whatever she says goes is her house.
I'm feeling it.
I'm going to set this up. My sister called me on the phone and she said, listen, can you please talk to your nephew and tell him that when I tell him to be in the house at 10 o'clock, that's what I mean.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm on the other end like, okay, well, what do you want me to say?
Mm-hmm.
It's your house. So he gets on the phone and he goes, Nick, I should be able to come in the house whenever I want to. I'm 15. You know, I got things to do. I got people I need to see. I said, what did your mama say?
I would ask him, do you got a jobby job?
I said, what did your mama say?
That's right.
It's her house. If she tells you to be in at 10 o'clock, you have your behind in at 10 o'clock, not 10:01, not 10:05, not 10:10. If she tells you to be in at 10 o'clock, you best to get in at 10 o'clock.
That's right.
That basically means that at 9:30,
mm-hmm.
depending upon where you are, 9 o'clock, you need to start wrapping your stuff up so that you can have your behind in the house at 10 o'clock. You cannot call me on the phone and have me arguing with your mama over something that she told you to do.
That's right.
What you want me to do?
That's right.
Then he goes, well, you know, you're my favorite aunt. I said, I understand, but that's also my sister, and we were sisters before you got here.
That's right. Yeah, that's right. And
okay.
Then you're going to be mad because the door's going to lock, and then you're going to have to find somewhere to sleep, and the bum on the crate ain't going to let – on the what thing they sleep on?
The ground.
They're not going to let you sleep on the ground.
What?
So, now, I was thinking like the vent, you know what I mean? But no, that's real talk, though, Nick, because what you're speaking to is the village raising kids. Because the rules, it's like this. When we went over our aunt's house, the same rules applied at my mom's house. Mm-hmm. Like, there has to be this commonality. Because kids will figure out that if I go over Aunt Gertrude's house, she gonna let me get away with some stuff that I can't get away with my house, and then
right.
Mom wonder why he wants to spend the night over her house every weekend.
Right.
But when everybody's speaking the same language, you have a village raising the kids. Everybody's reinforcing the same rules.
Listen, because I'm not gonna side with you.
That's right.
I'm gonna go with your mother.
That's right.
I don't care what the meaning is behind her wanting you to be in at 10 o'clock. If she says, hey, you need to be in at 10 o'clock, then that's what time you need to be in the house.
Mm-hmm.
You cannot be arguing with your mother about what time to come in. Now, you said you're 15. Are you helping out with the bills?
That's right.
Are you paying her rent?
Mm-hmm.
You know? Are you using, I see you using more than you're paying.
Right.
You got all them gadgets and everything up in your room, all them core. He got all them games and stuff.
He got Disney World in his room, so that's when he get on punishment, he actually looked forward to be on punishment because he got everything in the room.
He got this almost a 60-inch television in his room because
right.
when he does his driving games, he needs to see all the cars.
He got to see all the cars.
You know what I'm saying? So your room is laid out like it's a darn arcade.
Right, for real.
Okay, and then
after punishment is over, he keeps himself on punishment so he can still stay in there and play with that car game.
I know. Because
he got everything in. He got the phone, the stereo, he got a roller coaster in there, and video games. It's out of control, man.
Okay, and he ain't helping out with that.
Ain't helping out with no bill.
All that stuff he got in his room, he's not helping with pay that electric bill. I know that electric bill is high as crap.
Now, check this out. Then, to add to what you're saying, then they want to get grown and say, well, I'm leaving the house.
Well, get out then.
And then they want to go over their man's house or their girlfriend's house. And then when the parent there start realizing that the water done doubled, the electric done doubled, they got to buy more grocery, then they got to go back to them and say, it's time for your friend.
Let me tell you, I remember that time I told my mother I was leaving. I remember.
My mom would help me pack my bags.
No, my mother said, okay, go pack your stuff. And I got 2 steps.
Mm-hmm.
She said, well, wait a minute, pack your stuff.
Right.
Meaning everything that you bought.
Right, right, right.
Pack that.
And you had like one little shopping bag, didn't you?
I have nothing.
Oh, man.
So she said, take some clothes off because you didn't buy those clothes.
Right, right.
You know, don't you're basically going to walk out here butt naked.
Right, right.
Because you didn't buy nothing. I bought the clothes on your back, the shoes on your feet. The barrettes I had in my hair, she said, I bought them too, so take it all off.
That's right. Yeah. And then you got this generation that they don't like the rules at home, so they kind of
mm-hmm.
want to go to placement.
Yeah.
So you could go to a placement where the rules is worse than they were at home.
Listen.
You know what I'm saying? I know of stories.
I'm telling you. I know some stories too. I have a few friends who were in, what is it called, DHS or something
like
that?
That's right, yes. Residential treatment, foster home.
They ran away from one home, went to the next home, and it was worse than the one they ran from.
That's right.
And they couldn't go back to that home, so they had to deal with it at
right.
the new place.
And then sometimes you'll get the mom or the grandma say, let them stay where you're at.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So it's
you know,
right, yeah, it's right.
I mean, what you want me to do?
Right.
I'm going to side with your mother. At 15, you know, some kids, you know, today, they do whatever they want to do. But when you have a loving parent in the home, whether it's a two-parent home or a single-parent home, when you have that, you do what they say.
That's right.
You know, if she's saying come in the house at 10, first of all, you come in the house at 10, that's late.
That is late.
On a school night?
I know that is late. I remember when I was little, we had to be on the step by the time that light pole came.
Yes.
Out. You know what I'm saying? And then we had to be in the house at a certain time, and if you didn't make it in the house by some chance, the doors got locked.
That meant you had
another place to stay if you couldn't obey the rules.
Yeah.
And guess how many times me and my brother got locked out of our house because we didn't make it on purpose?
How many times?
One time.
Because it only takes one time.
All it takes is one.
Right. Listen.
My dad locked that door.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, of course, my mom wanted to come down there and sneak us in.
Yes,
but my dad was like, no, let them stay out there.
Uh-huh.
But we learned a valuable lesson. And we're not saying that everything that was old school was perfect parenting, But it worked. It got good results. Yeah. We grew up to be good, decent citizens. We hold steady jobs.
Yeah.
We're creative. We're into acting. We're doing good for ourselves. We didn't embarrass our parents by getting locked up, thrown in jail in the youth study center, so they did something right.
Yes.
And you're talking about that old school form of parenting.
Exactly.
Whatever auntie say, I'm going to say the same thing. In fact, don't come to me with that.
Don't get off my phone.
Get off my phone.
Get off my phone.
And you ain't pay for that.
Hello.
Because you ain't got a job to pay for the phone that you on.
Exactly.
Got
exactly.
the nerve.
Stop calling me with that nonsense.
There you go.
Do what your mama tell you. Get off my phone. That's it. That's all I got.
That's it, man. Well, look. That was great. That was enough right there. You know what I'm saying? You heard it firsthand. We're going to take a break. We come back. We might have Kevin's Corner. Kevin and Nikki Show on iHeartRadio.
Yeah.
We everywhere.
Thank you for allowing me to see myself the way you see me. Thank you. God whispering in your ear, letting you know that everything that has happened is now. It's all gone. Every sin, every mistake, every failure, it's all gone. Depression, gone. My faith, it's gone.
yesterday.
It's gone.
It's all gone.
It's gone.
It's gone.
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 What your mother did.
Gone.
What your father did.
It's gone.
Hallelujah.
Kevin and Nikki show on iHeartRadio.
Wow. Man, that's a powerful song,
that is,
man.
A powerful song.
I don't know if I can come behind that one.
Oh, you want to do it, though.
Woo!
You want to do it.
That's great. But, yeah, man, it's time for Kevin's Corner. It's that time where we just want to motivate, encourage, inspire. We want to just invade your perspective with positivity, man, that we would, like Kurt Franklin said, you know, imagine yourself, you know, being great. Imagine yourself accomplishing that dream. Imagine that you are pretty. You are wonderful. You are, you're the real deal. You're a big deal. So I saw a post that said, change your perspective and it'll change your reality. You know, sometimes in our lives, our surroundings might not change, or our circumstances might not change, or our situations might not change, but if we can change our perspective in terms of how we look at it, that's a change. We live in a life where we're on this quest for happiness, but we also live in a life where we also desire peace. And so if somehow, some way, we can change our perspective of that unloving situation, that unpeace, that situation that lacks peace, it can bring us peace. It can bring us love. It can bring us joy. So today what I want my listeners, our listeners, to do is we're going to eliminate the what did I do wrong question. It's the human experience when you've been mistreated, you've been beat down, you've been bullied, taken advantage of, abused, victimized. The human experience says, especially when those experiences have been repeated, what did I do wrong, or what did I do to deserve that? And as we've said before on our show, that how people treat you is not a reflection of you, it's a reflection of who they are.
Yeah.
So we want to eliminate the what did I do wrong, what did you do wrong to deserve that bad relationship? What did you do wrong to deserve the negative treatment? You didn't do anything wrong.
Yeah.
You didn't do anything wrong. Today, we're going to abandon that question from here on out. We're going to throw it in the sea of forgetfulness. With all your mistakes, like everybody has made, you're still not deserving a bad treatment. You're still not deserving a punishment. You're still not deserving, because who is an imperfect person to treat another imperfect person bad for being imperfect? Well, I guess that eliminates everybody on planet Earth. So, no, you're not deserving of negative treatment. So we're going to take that what did I do wrong question, we're going to throw it in the sea of forgetfulness, and from this day forward in our lives, and it's going to take some revisiting, we're going to view ourselves or imagine ourselves that we're worthy of love, that we are worthy to be treated well, that we are worthy of starting that business. We're worthy of accomplishing that dream. We're worthy of being cast. We're worthy of having peace. We're worthy of having joy. We're worthy of it. You didn't do anything wrong. You didn't do anything to deserve any kind of bad treatment. It was their issue. It was their insecurity. It was their anger issue. It was their control issue. It was their jealousy of you, and much, much more. And hey, Kirk said it. Imagine me. Hey, man, I can see it. Can you see it too? And if you can, I can see it for you.
That's
be
awesome.
Great. Be great. Continue to dream. One love.
That's awesome. That's
it.
Awesome.
Quick with
that
this, flip
awesome.
With this.
Yep. That's all right, it, man. Put that social media.
You're going to put it out there. Hey, look, this is actor Kevin D. Benton. You can follow me on Facebook at Kevin D. Benton. Follow me on Twitter at Kevin D. Benton. And we'd love to connect with you. And, Nick, you're going to put your stuff
all
out there.
All right. You can follow me on Facebook, Nikee Warren. Follow me on Twitter at Nikee Warren. Instagram, hello, I'm Nikee. And that's spelled HELLOIMNIKEE. Now, for the Kevin and Nikee show.
That's right.
You can follow us on Twitter. The Kevin Nikee Show, at The Kevin Nikee Show. Facebook, The Kevin and Nikee Show. And you can also, if you have any questions, comments, concerns, you have any questions for Garry Cobb, you have any questions for Kevin, what we talked about, Kevin's Corner, what's bothering Nikee, you want to hear my grandma prayer, hit us up on Yahoo, The Kevin and Nikee Show at
yahoo.com. I'm looking in. The Kevin and Nikee Show at
yahoo.com.
Yahoo.com. Hit us up.
Yes.
We'd love to hear from you.
This has been awesome.
It's awesome.
Awesome. And
it's going to get better.
Yeah.
We love it.
The Kevin and Nikee Show on iHeartRadio. We
Nya, nya, nya. Ba, ba, Babwe, Zimbabwe. The broken Bunsen burner burns so bright. South.
Jamie.
Southeast Asian Peninsula.
Hey, Jamie.
Yes.
I think the only line we need from you today is drivers who switch to Progressive could save big.
Cool. I just got to finish my warm-ups. Foul, foul, throw in the towel. History, history.
Switch
history,
to Progressive history, today.
Santa ski slalom in a salmon skin suit.
Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates.
This weekend, unplug. Getting closer to nature can get you closer to your family. To find the forest nearest you, go to discovertheforest.org. Brought to you by the U.S. Forest Service and the Ad Council. Discovertheforest.org. Brought to you by the U.S. Forest Service and the Ad Council.
Nya, nya, nya. Ba, ba, Babwe, Zimbabwe. The broken Bunsen burner burns so bright. South.
Jamie.
Southeast Asian Peninsula.
Hey, Jamie.
Yes.
I think the only line we need from you today is drivers who switch to Progressive could save big.
Cool. I just got to finish my warm-ups. Foul, foul, throw in the towel. History, history.
Switch
history,
to Progressive history, today.
Santa ski slalom in a salmon skin suit.
Progressive Casualty Insurance Company and Affiliates.
This weekend, unplug. Getting closer to nature can get you closer to your family. To find the forest nearest you, go to discovertheforest.org. Brought to you by the U.S. Forest Service and the Ad Council.